It's so great to be here with you again. This is my second Pennsylvania State Atheist Conference. Thank you. So, Victor is... where's Victor? Is he on a plane? Is he going to make it for tonight?
He'll be after you.
Ah, awesome. Okay. Oh. So I'll be reading some poetry. And then when Victor comes, he's going to do my set. But it's interesting, you know, you learn in school, hopefully, some of us, that you be critical of what the media is saying. So you don't really notice it until it hits home and it's about you. I think that one of the best uses of music is that it's an opportunity for discourse and discussion, and that's what I really like to do with my music. The first album that I ever released was called An Atheist Album, and thank you. That documented my very significant transition from a believing Jew to an atheist. And it was such a significant and exciting time for me that it brought forth a lot of songs. And I'd like to share some of those songs with you tonight. I'd like to share some new songs as well. This is a song that was inspired by a conversation that I had with an Orthodox Jewish member of my family. And we were talking about recycling. And he said, "I don't need to recycle, because God made the world for me, or for us, not just him. And there's nothing that we can do as humans to interfere with his plan. The world will be here for as long as God wants it, and there's nothing that we could do to impact that in any way." And I just thought that's such a dangerous way of thinking about our relationship to the planet and our responsibility in prolonging our existence here in this beautiful place that we find ourselves. And so this song is about that idea and some of the other ideas that are harmful that come from a belief in an afterlife rather than a focus on this life, which we know we have for sure. This song is called Afterlife. Follow the guidebook for an afterlife. Which one do I try? Which one do I try? I'd like to believe that I'll never die, but I can't comply. No, I can't comply. And all the self-appointed representatives of their own imaginings in the sky, they want to usher in the messianic age. They don't mind if it's brought on by nuclear rage. They are so sure of their ability to outlive the utility of their bodies. But just remember the words that I start in the brain of every suicide bomber in every hijacked plane. Follow the guidebook for coming, that the second coming's coming. Environmental responsibility is the coming through the suicidal longing for paradise. Can they see it so many before our eyes? When all that makes us who we are, we find cannot survive without our mind. We're so afraid to die, you're willing to sacrifice. Living through it all with the knowledge that you only have one life. Follow the guidebook for afterlife. Which one do I believe that I'm thought of. The way that I deal with it is to treasure each moment with my surroundings. Know that I love. I spend my days trying to engage with the world, to learn as much about everything as I can. Anybody mounts a shared heritage to further understand historical and evolutionary context. Of the song was used to be my favorite prayer, and it's one of the Sabbath prayers that they say to make sure that the house is properly prepared for the Sabbath. So the angels of God are coming to inspect the home and see if it's properly prepared. And I use my very useful Hebrew skills to do a play on the words, and instead of saying the angels from God, I change it to say, who is God? Who is God? I am God. The only other time that my Hebrew came in actual very much handy to me was in North Egypt. I was in Taba, and the locals didn't speak English, and I didn't speak Arabic, but we both spoke Hebrew, so that was very handy. I learned modern Hebrew in school. I went to a Jewish school from kindergarten all the way through, and I learned to speak modern Hebrew. And we also learned biblical Hebrew so that we could properly read the Tanakh and do all that intertextual studies that Richard was talking about today. Not to such a sophisticated level, but you know, comparing paragraphs, and I loved it. It was such an important part of my life, my Jewish identity, my religion. I went to a Jewish Zionist socialist youth group on the weekend, and I learned about Israel, and eventually as I got older I would run programs for the children and teach them about Israel and Zionism. And I went to an Orthodox synagogue. So at home we had a more conservative level of observance. And but a synagogue where we went, it was the Orthodox kind of Judaism. I'm not sure if you're familiar with it, but they have gender segregation. So the women will sit upstairs, and if you can't make it upstairs, you can sit down the back with a curtain in front of you, called a mechitza, and you're not allowed to participate in leading the service. That is up to the men and the rabbis, who are the leaders in the community. And the school I went to was also a conservative level of observance, so not even the most religious, but even in primary school we had a prayer that we would say every morning, and it was a call and response between the boys and the girls. And the boys would say in Hebrew, "Dear God, thank you for not making me a woman." And we would reply back, "Dear God, thank you for making me what I am." And in Orthodox Judaism, a woman's voice is not allowed to be heard unaccompanied because it's too arousing, which is true. And everyone has my permission to leave so they don't find themselves overcome. But this would manifest in interesting ways for me. I grew up singing in my father's Jewish wedding band. That's how I learned to sing and play guitar, playing at weddings and bar mitzvahs. And sometimes the rabbis hadn't gone home yet, because you're supposed to wait till the rabbis go home at a function before you can start the mixed dancing and before you can get the top 40 party going. And I would get up and start singing and they would run over, "No, quick, get off the stage, get off the stage." Orthodox men and women aren't allowed to touch each other unless they're married, and even then in public it's not so invited. And the family rabbi would come to our house and he would shake my father's hand, he would shake my brother's hand, and "Hi, Shelley." he was cool, we had an air high five that we worked out. But just these rules, these different rules that are placed on you because you are born in a way and as a kind that you have no control over, which dictates your role, which dictates how you are defined. And so this next song is a little snippet, using all those little snippets of what it was like for me as a young woman in Judaism, and also based on what I've heard from a lot of women growing up in the Abrahamic tradition. The song is called Eve. Tells me I was made for from man. I'm stupid for him, everything that I can. I must surrender to his will. I must submit. I can't make the household decisions, cause I am unfit.
Painful.
At the front? Oh, good. One of the best things about writing songs from real life is that you can exact interesting revenge on people. this is a song that I wrote after a romantic liaison, where the gentleman I was with wanted me to change the way that I looked for him. And it got me thinking about the aesthetic expectations that are placed on us by society, by the media, by the people around us, and even sometimes by ourselves. And you know, I wrote this song about that pressure, which exists because we are such visual creatures, but at the same time it's questioning whether that's something we can overcome. And I just released this song, it's my single out at the moment, and I got to talk about this experience in the media, which is, as I said before, you know, music is a great opportunity for discourse and discussion. And everyone was asking me about this gentleman. They said, well, does he have a six-pack? That's not important, but no. it's a powerful way to get a message and a discussion across, and also an interesting way to make someone think twice about what they said. this song is called Sideline. Thank you. self-consciousness come tumbling down from the shelf. But this is familiar, but who we've become, slaves to aesthetic. This is the tune, this is the tune that we hum. Can we change who we are? Can we remove the filter from all our hearts? If you're not beautiful, we'll be sidelined. Can we let go of our pride, of how we look on the outside? Anyways, I feel love supposed to be blind, be blind. This next song came out of a discussion that I've had quite often since becoming an atheist and starting to have conversations about it with people that I meet. And every once in a while, someone will say to you, maybe more often here, will say to you, how can you be a good person without God? And how do you know the difference between what's right and what's wrong? And what's great about a song is that it's really a 4-minute uninterrupted opinion. Well, hopefully uninterrupted. And this is my 4-minute uninterrupted opinion on how I know the difference between what's right and what's wrong. And it's called My Morality. From above, my morality is not set into stone tablets. We don't even tell you that it's worthwhile to be good for being good's own sake, but not to think for yourself can be a deadly mistake. My morality is not recitable from memory. It's something inside of me. How I want to be, treat others how I want them to treat me. Basically, not to hurt anybody or pose any brutality. Stems from a common humanity, and it's what my mother taught to me, and it's mine because I'm three. So this year I released a new EP. It's called Strange Feeling, and I'm really, really excited about it. It was my first time in the studio getting to spend that much time on each song. We had like 2 days on each song, and had a full string arrangement come in, and cellos and violins, and it was really beautiful, and I'm very proud of it and very excited about it. And I'd love to share a couple of those new songs with you. This is the first track on the EP. This is called Background Noises. I wrote this about a divorce of my friend's. And my friend called me to tell me what had happened. And I sat back in my bed and I tried to imagine what it would feel like to have such a change after such a long time. Song about going to the movies. Well, this is actually the tuning song. This song is called Cinema Chair. About the stromatolites. Has anyone heard about the stromatolites? So the stromatolites were the earliest life form on the planet, and they existed 3.5 billion years ago. So first living thing on the planet, well, by our definition. And it's a cyanobacteria that lives in the ocean, and they would wash up on the shore, and over thousands and thousands of years they would collect and they would form these rock-like structures. So they look like rocks, but they're really alive. And they have this chemical reaction that would release oxygen. And so it's the stromatolites that are responsible for the oxygenation of the early earth. And and they exist today in modern form in two places in the world. One is in South America, and the other is on the west coast of Australia. And I'm on the east coast, where I live in Melbourne, but Australia is nearly the size of the US, actually. It always surprises people when we talk about it. So I went on this pilgrimage of sorts to visit the stromatolites. And I drove 22 hours north from Perth up to Shark Bay. And I got out of my car and I walked out onto the pier. And I looked over and I saw the stromatolites. And they look just like rocks. But if you stay for long enough, you can see a bubble of oxygen coming. And while I was there with the stromatolites, I had this transcendent experience where I felt overwhelmed with a deep sense of gratitude. I felt gratitude for my life, for the capacity that we have, for that depth of emotion, and for those transformative, transcendent experiences. I felt grateful to science, to scientists and people who've dedicated their life to the body of knowledge so that I can look at what my brain tells me is a rock and know that it's so much more, and at least in lay terms, understand its relevance to the history of life on Earth and its place in my own existence. And on the way home, I wrote this song, and it's about that feeling of gratitude, that deep feeling of gratitude, but holding on to it in spite of all of the suffering and hardships that life can bring. And in spite of the discontent that we feel, I think we see what's wrong with the world, we see what we want to fix and what we want to change, and we can be angry and frustrated at the imperfections, and we can be driven to improve it, but that doesn't mean that we're not grateful at the same time, even if we don't have someone to be grateful to. I feel grateful to the rocks, and I hope no one could hear me, and I leaned over and I whispered, "Thank you, rocks." This song is called Gratitude. Life can be hard, things can get rough, stay on your guard and protect good stuff. Sometimes we all feel like we've had enough, don't want to spend my short time feeling down. So I will express my anger where credit is due, but it won't take away from my gratitude. There's nowhere to hide when you live in a cage. You feel young inside, but on the outside you age.
Transcendence.
confusion runs deep, and it's hard to know what's wrong. Sometimes you can't sleep, and you get lonely at night. But you decide that you keep on. How does everyone feel about a cheeky song? We didn't have the PG announcement. Is that okay?
PG!
It's after 8 o'clock, right? That's the rule. So this is about an ex-boyfriend I had. I was working at the market selling socks, and opposite from my stall there was a live fish stall, and they were selling fish as pets, and they had these salamanders, little axolotls. They're like eels with arms and legs, and I've always liked them, because I imagine that's what our ancestors would have looked like. And I just had gone through this terrible breakup, and I thought, I'm going to buy myself a salamander, and it's going to be a new friend and a comfort and a wonderful distraction, and I'll feel better. And so I spent more than the money I made that day at the market, and I bought the tank and the rocks and the little plastic castle and the water filter and the water conditioner and the worms and the net and the salamander himself. And I brought him home to my family, who I was living with at the time. And we said, quick, Mum, Dad, Josh, look what I got. And we opened up the bag, and he was dead. And so I wrote this song about my dead salamander and my ex-boyfriend. And it's called The Salamander Song. I dreamed of you last night, and then my salamander died. I wish that you had died. Then maybe I could start to forget, and I would have had a pretty cool pet. But now my salamander's dead. Shit to do. Just sit around in your room watching your life go to waste. Just like you, he would have been a distraction to pacify me with my own inaction. It feels like all my efforts being bury him in the park, but I couldn't be fucked waiting for it to get dark. Had to do something soon before the smell settled in. It hurt that you weren't there to hold my hand. I guess not everything can go as planned. So I put him in a shoebox, and I threw him in a bin. not in good taste to tell myself you are both easily replaced. But what else can I do? Make myself feel better. I wrote this song while I was hitchhiking around Europe, and I've been waiting with my friend on the freeway outside Amsterdam. We've been waiting for 4 hours with our thumbs out, and a gentleman spotted us, and he slowed down, pulled over, and motioned for us to come. So we put on our packs, and we started walking over, and he started laughing and drove away. Something you would do, Mark?
That's not funny.
It is funny, that's why I said it. But I can understand why someone wouldn't want to pick up a hitchhiker, but to go out of your way to put someone else down just really riled me up, and I felt like, you know, people are awful to each other, strangers are awful to each other, and if you don't look the same or you're coming from a different place, people aren't going to help you out. And while I was writing, and I started writing a song about that feeling, and while I was writing this song about how strangers are awful to each other, another gentleman walked past where I was sitting and gave me a big pile of change. I think he assumed that I was busking. And so I couldn't keep writing this song about how strangers are awful to each other when a complete stranger had just given me a pile of money. And so the song morphed into a big cheesy love song to everyone in the world. It's called a hitchhiking song. And I will still love you for whatever it's worth. To dedicate to Rob. I don't know, for those of you who got to meet Rob yesterday, he had to fly back home to Australia this morning. But I like to dedicate this song to Rob. He's my roadie, my guitar tech, my accompaniment, and my concubine. he did a fantastic job. He was on the road with me for 6 weeks. We've been playing shows around the States now. And yeah, so now I'm solo. Looking for a concubine? No. But you have to be able to play guitar. Well, depends how good you are at other things. Victor! this is called My Word. My.
A concubine!
I. Word. My word, my word, I'll give you my word on it. You can build your dreams. I'll give you my word. Sewn back together at the seams. I'll give you my word. Ain't never gonna be no diamond ring, but honey, my word, yeah, it's the strongest thing. I wanna tell you in a beautiful, complicated way to show you how it feels, but the words on their own, it's straight to the bone. My word, my word, my word. I give you my time, on it you can set the pace. I give you my time, give you my growing old, my changing face. I give you my time, which I can never refuse. I give you my time, cause you give me that through. But that day, oh, I wanna dress it up nice and pretty fairy lights to show ya how it feels. But the words on their own is straight to the bone. My word. My word. My word. See how far I can stretch the cheeky stuff. I haven't done this at a conference before, so thank you for making me feel comfortable enough to try it. This is a very special love song for a very special man. Thank you. $100 you can. Thank you. The first time I played that song to my family, my dad's like, "Is that what I got you a webcam for?" And I was like, "Absolutely." My dad's the president of the synagogue. And he's pretty amazing, actually. He accompanied me on the violin for the Global Atheist Convention in Australia, even as a representative, well, as a representative of himself, but it was pretty cool. This is a song that I wrote after an interaction in the street with a preacher, and he told me very kindly and very politely that I was going to hell and I was going to burn forever. And I felt very angry about this. You know, who can come into my space and tell me how I should live my life and put their morality onto me, their sexual morality onto me, their religious ideology onto me? I won't be told how to live my life. The song is called Saved. Say that I need to be saved. Say with me, the devil got his way. I want to know how when you are praying, when you are doing, staying, how you think you know that someone is listening to what you are saying. So if Brian wants the internet chat room song. Like, already done.
I got it for you, Brian.
Do we have time for one more? Is everyone feeling all right? And then... This is my favorite song to play. It was dedicated to and inspired by Christopher Hitchens. Who was a very, very big influence on me when I was going through this significant change in worldview. And he talked about the universe as being unfriendly to life. And our galaxy is headed towards another galaxy, the impending heat death of the universe. And he used this to dispel the idea that we are the center of the universe, and the universe is created for us and for life. And really, we are cosmically insignificant. Nothing that we do can have any impact on the cosmos. Actually, in that way, I'm agreeing with my uncle now. But, in the tangible way, on this planet, in the way that we think, in the way that we treat each other, the way that we act and interact, and even what we believe, our thoughts, have a tangible impact in this world now, and that makes us significant, I think. And so I like to contrast our cosmic insignificance with our real world insignificance, because it's our interactions with people that has the meaning, the only meaning that we could ever have, and gives me a deep sense of meaning and makes me feel worthwhile to be here with you today. So this song is called Apocalyptic Love Song for Hitchens. One day the sun is going to die. For us it means no more sunsets to the universe. But I'm a star in the sky. Almost all who ever lived have already died. Countless stories of love and war and hope. Pain now silently, side by side. And yes, I understand that my whole life is just a blink of an eye. And the history of the earth is with each moment that goes by. But this moment that I'm with you feels like time has stood still. Oceans will dry, while somehow life may continue. There will not be known to you and I to think we are so important is an obvious crime.